Hi, I'm Gregoire Fairlight, and you might know me from the band Qu4ys. And this evening, whenever you're watching this, I thought I'd do a bit of a rig rundown. Today, Simon is actually in the studio, but he's the person holding the camera. So, yes, this side of the studio is where we use for basically sound sources, creating sounds, doing sound design, and doing some of the early pre-production and songwriting for the idea. So I'm going to talk you through some of the key items that we've been using on the tracks that you might have heard so far. So first of all, we do use a MacBook Pro for our sequencer, our door, and that we're using Machine and Native Instruments Machine. We're using a Curious Spark LE, and we're also using Reason 10 for songwriting. I then shift it into Pro Tools for recording with real instruments, just because it just suits my workflow. But from a starting point, we're using, you know, fairly common doors. I really do like Machine. It is like a cross between like Ableton and an old school Akai MPC, which I think is pretty cool. So we're going to start with this synthesizer here. I wish it was a real 303, but it's not. It's a Behringer TD3, I don't know. And it's in the limited edition acid yellow. I love it. I've used it on one of the songs. It's probably 99% of a 303 in sound, but 100% of the user experience, which could be a good thing or a bad thing depending on how you feel about programming a traditional 303 sequencer. I like the challenge and the learning experience. So we've been using that. It doesn't do a huge variety. It's a 303, and you get a 303. So that's a good start. Then got another Behringer synthesizer. This is the Behringer Crave, which is a take on Moog's Mother 32, I think. So this is a semi-modular synthesizer, one voice, one filter, one envelope, one LFO, but you've got all the patch capabilities here, and it sounds really, really nice. You've got like a sequential circuits profit style oscillator with a Moog ladder filter. So I like that a lot, and that's been used for quite a few textures, bass sounds and stuff like that. Next thing we've got, Machine Micro. I didn't need the full size Machine controller. This gives me enough of what I need. On top of that, the Korg NTS1 in collaboration with New Tech. I had to look at this. This is a monster of a little synthesizer. It is, we've used this for one of the lead lines on Sweep Me Out to Sea. So that lead synth, even though I've got all this stuff, was done with one of these. So that's a really, really good bit kit. Next thing, this will be more used for our live performances, and this is the Roland MX-1. It's a performance mixer. It gives you the ability to do a whole host of things, and to be honest, I'll probably do a separate video on that on by itself. Next we've got, which we've used for some of the vocoding, is a Roland VT4. I have a VT3 as well, which does a few differences. We will be using this for live performances as well. Next to that, distortion. You can't go wrong with distortion. Everyone loves distortion. This is an Electron Analog Heat. It is a fantastic analog filter, and about 8 different types of analog distortion with a load of synthesis capabilities and stuff like that. It's an interesting unit. It's an audio processor made by a synthesizer company, effectively. So yeah, I like these so much. I have one over there for other conventional band stuff. So there's that. Volker FM by Korg. I've had quite a few of the Korg Volkers, but I've kind of just stuck and kept the ones that I think truly are amazing. Basically a DX7 in a very small form factor with the ability to change tones a lot easier than trying to program an FM synthesizer on a DX7. A lot of the arpeggiator stuff is one of these. It's really funny because I'm looking at him and his arm's starting to shake now because he's getting tired holding this camera. So there's that. Here we have the Soulsby at Megatron. I think it's Matt Soulsby, great guy, really good customer service and stuff like this. This is the at Megatron with the variety of personalities that you can load into it. So we've used that for quite a bit. And the Chillier Micro Freak, again, bass sounds, a really, really good synthesizer. If there's anything that you want me to go into more detail on, just write in the comments beneath and I'll kind of go into a bit more than that. Original old school Yamaha sampler from the mid 90s. The very first edition of Future Music that I bought back way back in 1996 reviewed this, so I kind of got this more for nostalgia. But then I did see Qu4ys using loads live, and Qu4ys is an amazing scratch DJ and artist in his own right. He's a Canadian guy, and probably the guy responsible for the most entertaining gig I've ever been to. So that, I got one of those and I've been using it. It's I don't want it for a hi-fi, I'm using it more for lo-fi. And moving swiftly on, we have another Volker modular. This one is the Volker. This is a Volker modular, which is more like a Buckler style synthesizer. I'll be honest and say I'm still trying to get my head around this because it is bonkers. And it does have the cutest little patch leads, if I can get it without dropping them all on the carpet, you've ever seen in your life. Look at those. So, but it is capable of pretty cool stuff. Now, kind of going more British kind of sound now. So, Innovation Monostation. It is a two-voice analog synthesizer similar to a base station. And I've used this quite a bit. I'm still trying to kind of, again, too many choices, not knowing where to start. But the sequencer on this is really, really good, and I've been using that for quite a long time. Old school retro Roland gear here. This is an old It's an old Roland SP-808 that came out in 1998, and I've pretty much had it since then. I got the optional output board for this. Yes, it's limited. It has a very old school way of working, but I will never sell it. I love it. The effects on these are amazing. It has a workflow that I really, really enjoy. And due to the fact it does have a lot of limitations. So yes, if you see one of these and you like working away from a computer, this is really, really cool. The only thing is you do get, well, you have to get these USB zip disks. Not USB, what am I talking about? Zip 100 megabyte zip disks. This is something I hadn't really thought about. But that one's working. The infamous zip disk whine. But what this could do in 1998, if you were to buy the equivalent with a computer, would have cost a lot of money. So yeah, and it's got a D-beam controller, so it's a bit like a modern day theremin project. The only thing that I've done with this one that is different to standard is they came out with an EX model in 2000, and I took the software, operating software from the EX, and put it on here because I think the color of this one looks better than the remake. So, yeah, there's that. Moving over, I have another Behringer item. This is a Behringer's clone of a TR-808, and it's I'm still kind of getting my head around it and stuff, but it's really, really nice to have again something that is like the stuff that I wish I could have afforded in the 90s, but it was too expensive. Beneath that is a Behringer's version of a Roland SH-101. Again, they pretty much nailed this. They've added a couple of other things like FM not synthesis, but the ability to add FM overtones, which gives it a lot more versatility. The bottom end on this is nuts. Yeah, absolutely amazing. Yeah, this thing's got balls. Wallace Grandes, that's all I'm saying. And then underneath that, I have a Roland JD-XI synthesizer that is just a really, really nice synthesizer that gives a lot of stuff. It's even got a one voice analog engine in there as well. We'll probably be using that for live. And then finally, we've got just some blue sky monitors for just listening and stuff up here. His little arms shaking, it's hilarious. He's like, oh, he tells me he works out, but It would appear not. So yeah, so there you go. That is part of a little bit of a rig rundown of some of the things that we're using. Some old, some new versions of old, and stuff like that. So yes, I probably just rambled for a good few minutes on stuff. Let me know your thoughts. If, as I said, if you want me to if you want me to do a video in more detail of certain items, put them in the comments beneath. Smash that bell there, not entirely sure where, and let me know what your thoughts. What gear do you use? What am I missing out on? What should my next purchase be? So anyway, stay safe, have a great Christmas, and Simon is nodding and saying have a good Christmas and New Year, and we will speak to you soon. All right, cheers, bye.